Hello and welcome to this fourth tutorial made for 24houranswers.com where we learn to be a better programmer. This time we'll be looking at another core element of programming, loop statements. As before, our focus is on C and C++, but these concepts apply to any high-level programming language. Loop statements are a collection of tools that allow you to iteratively perform actions in code. For example, if you wanted to print the numbers 1 through 10, you could do this by writing 10 printf statements, each one displaying one of the numbers, but this would mean writing a lot of unnecessary code. A faster, more maintainable, and easier to read way of doing this is to use a loop statement to declare a variable, and then add 1 to and print the variable value 10 times. Then, if you wanted to expand your code to print the numbers up to 1000, you could do this with one small code change, instead of adding another 990 printf statements. Similarly, you could alter the logic completely to print, say, the Fibonacci series or prime numbers. Whilst you can easily count up to a number yourself, the strength of the computer is it is able to rapidly compute values in this way, and the loop statement is the way to achieve this. As a general rule, when designing a program, loop statements are clearly usable whenever you're performing the same action again and again. This may be processing a database output, drawing a table on screen, taking user input to run the program, and so on. The first big programming project that I worked on, back when I was learning C, was an online role-playing game that was essentially a huge loop statement. Each iteration of the loop, the game read the last input from all the connected players, processed that input, and displayed the output to their screen. Once you understand how to code, the mechanics of large and complex programs like this will start to become obvious to you, and this will form part of your ongoing learning process. So now we'll look at how you utilize these loop statements. There are three basic types: the for statement, the while statement, and the do while statement. Other languages might have different syntaxes or modified forms of these, but fundamentally the same process is going on. In our first example, we are using a while statement. The syntax is simple. First, we have declared an integer I, which we will use as a loop counter. Next is the while statement itself. You can create this by using the keyword while and then putting a logical condition in the brackets, just like an if statement. In this case, we're stating that our loop will only execute when the value of I is less than 10. In the body of our loop statement, between the curly braces, we define what will take place during each iteration of the loop. In this case, the current value of I will be printed, and then I will be incremented by 1. This is what the double plus symbol means: increment I by 1, and then use the new value of I. You can achieve the opposite result with two minus symbols, which would decrement the value of I by 1, and then use the new value. If you place the plus plus or minus minus symbols before the I, however, you would use the old value, and then increment the variable. The distinction is quite subtle, so don't worry if you aren't entirely sure how it works. Either experiment yourself or wait for us to cover in more detail later on. So in summary, the while statement will keep executing while the condition is met, I is less than 10. When I becomes equal to 10, the loop will break and execution will flow to the next line of code after the loop body. This for statement is a similar concept that gives you a finer grain of control over your code. This time, rather than having to increment your counter manually, the variable initialization, the incrementation, and the condition can all be conveyed in a single line. The for statement is broken into three parts. The first of these is the initializer, and this will happen the first time the code moves to this line and begins the for loop. You can declare variables in this part of the statement, and they will be valid for as long as the execution remains in the for loop. The second part, after the first semicolon, is your condition. This functions the same way as in the while statement. For as long as the condition is true, the block of code in the body of loop will keep executing. The last part of the second semicolon is the incrementer. It occurs after each iteration of the loop, and you generally use it to increase your counter variable. In my example, the condition is to keep executing for as long as I is less than 20. Each iteration of the loop, however, it will increase the counter by 2 instead of 1. That's the meaning of the plus equals symbol. For reference, you can do the same with multiplication, division, and subtraction by placing either of these symbols before the equals 2. In the body of the loop, I print the value of I as I have done in the other statements. In the next block, we have a do while loop. This works the same way as the while loop fundamentally, so I won't say too much about it. The key thing to notice is the different syntax and the fact that this loop will execute at least once every time without fail. Even if you wrote a condition such as while 1 equals 2, the body of the loop would still occur once. Finally, I'm going to talk about infinite loops, both deliberate and accidental. If you create a situation where a loop doesn't terminate, your program will essentially lock at that point, forcing you to kill it from the task manager. Generally speaking, it should be quite easy to find and fix these errors, but sometimes an infinite loop may even be desirable, and we'll look at how to achieve this in this last code segment. I mentioned before that my first code project was an online game. This is an example of where an infinite loop was pretty much required. Since the game should always be available for new players to connect, the execution takes place in a giant infinite loop. To achieve this, you simply create a while statement with the condition that is always true, such as this 1 equals 1. Notice, however, the use of two keywords, continue and break. Continue tells the program to perform the next iteration of the loop immediately. Rather than continue the rest of the loop body, we will jump back to the top of the code block again. The effect in this loop is that while 1 is less than 10, I will be printed and then incremented by 1. Once the value exceeds 10, however, it is incremented a second time so that the value will increase by 2 each iteration instead of 1. Finally, once the value is over 20, we hit the break statement. This is the complement to the continue statement, and will instead immediately break out of the current innermost loop, as if we had terminated by the condition no longer being met. As a result, we will print the values of 0 to 9, then all the odd numbers between 10 and 20, before terminating. I'm showing the output here. First of all, we have the output of our while loop, which had the condition I is less than 10. As a result, it's printed every number, inclusively, from 0 to 9. After that point, I is no longer less than 10, in other words, it's equal to 10, and so the loop stopped. Secondly, we have our for statement, where we had a similar condition, I is less than 20 and starting at 0, but this time we incremented I by 2 each time, and so we get 0, 2, 4, 6, 8, and so on up to 18. After this, we have our do while loop, which just demonstrated again counting from 0 to 10, but this time inclusively. Finally, we have our infinite loop, where we count every number between 0 and 9 in intervals of 1, and then switch to an interval of 2 to give us the odd numbers after that point. You should play around with this code and make sure that you understand how everything is working. If you have any questions, as always, feel free to post them below.